Good evening and welcome to Norwich Cathedral Organ Loft for this remote recital for the Guildford United Reformed Church audience. I'm delighted to be able to do this at this distance, although it's a shame not to actually be able to be there in person, as I much enjoyed my last visit. Much thanks to Gillian Lloyd for inviting me, and it's wonderful to have this technology that we'll be able to do this in this difficult time. I'm sitting here at the wonderful Hill Norman and Beard console, 1942. Here on my left is the wonderful Field of Daisies, as it was called by one of the people who worked on it. A great array of stops on that side, more than on that side. And we are very excited at the moment because in a year's time, the organ will be taken away and we're having a major rebuild, the first time it's been done in any format for over 70 years. So we're very excited about that. And the old lady is certainly showing her age. We've had some ciphers and missing notes and poor things going on, palettes falling apart. But I'm hoping tonight that she'll behave herself and all will be well. So welcome to Norwich Cathedral. I put in an extra piece tonight because I made a bit of a mistake with my timing. So we are going to get one more to give you your full hour of music. And I'm going to start with the wonderful piece of Whitlock. All organists love Whitlock. We love his style. He studied at the Royal College of Music with Stanford and Vaughan Williams. And much of his music reflects that lovely English style. But there are little hints of jazz and Rachmaninoff and people in his work. He's mainly known for his work in Bournemouth at St. Stephen's Church and at the Bournemouth Pavilion Theatre, but of course he was briefly assistant organist at Rochester Cathedral, and he died very young of tuberculosis. He was a great loss. And his organ music is rightly popular, for ranging from his lovely short pieces to the massive sonata and the wonderful Plymouth Suite. And of course he wrote orchestral music as well, and this wonderful march has been beautifully arranged by Malcolm Riley. And the title, Dignity and Impudence, relates to a picture by Sir Edwin Landseer, and it's a wonderful picture of a huge bloodhound and a small terrier, and the bloodhound is dignity and the terrier peeking round her side is impudence. And this is Whitlock's homage to Elgar, and Elgar is dignity and Whitlock has the impudence to try and copy his style, but he does it very well here. It's a wonderful march right in the pomp and circumstance style. So here we are to start with Dignity and Impudence by Percy Whitlock.
Thank you.
Now on to some pieces by Schumann. Schumann, of course, not really known as an organ composer, but a composer of beautiful piano music with a lovely concerto, songs, symphonies, a beautiful romantic composer. Many composers of his generation and before and after owned a pedal harpsichord or a pedal piano, just simply a piano with a load of pedals like an organ put on as well. And he wrote some pieces for that. They're not really organ pieces. The only organ pieces he really wrote were his wonderful six fugues on Bach's name. But the sketches are really four little character pieces, quite pianistic, but giving you an opportunity to raise all sorts of colours of the organ. And the moods are quite varied. There's quite an aggressive one in the third one, but it ends with a very lovely quiet dance in D flat major. So four sketches by Schumann. Now, one thing that all the composers on tonight's programme have in common, of course, is their veneration of Bach. And I'm going to play the wonderful B minor prelude and fugue. And this is quite unusual because there is an autographed copy of Bach's handwriting of this piece, which is wonderful to look at. And it's quite unusual because many of them have been lost and we have reconstructions rather than the real thing. It was written in Leipzig when he was there around about 1730. And the prelude is a wonderful stately piece with running semi-quavers and leaping octaves in the pedal and some wonderful tortuous harmonies. And the fugue is a little bit more straightforward and is really based on just a very simple marching subject, which is very much by step. But perhaps because it marches onwards and by step, it builds to a wonderful finish. So here is the prelude and fugue in B minor by Bach. Well, we've had Whitlock, Schumann and Bach, and I said that I thought my programme was perhaps a little bit short, and I didn't want to shortchange you, so I'm putting in a piece of Mozart. Now, of course, Mozart, like Schumann, is not known for his organ music, although we do believe he coined the phrase the king of instruments in relation to the organ, but we're not quite sure whether that really was him, and he probably did play the organ very brilliantly, but didn't write any organ music like Beethoven and like Haydn, but they did write pieces for glass harmonicas and musical clocks. And the two great fantasias that we have for the organ by Mozart, the really big, wonderful one, K508, and the shorter one, this one that's in F minor and major, were written for mechanical clocks and have been arranged for the organ, and they work very well. This is a really beautiful piece. It has an opening slow section in F minor and a closing slow section in F minor, and then in the middle, a very joyful F major section. So here is the fantasia in F minor and major by Mozart.
Thank you.
Now we're getting one or two composers who are not known specifically for the organ. Saint-Saëns was not actually appreciated at all, really, in his time as a composer, but he was a very distinguished organist and was organist at La Madeleine, the huge church in Paris, for over 20 years. And he wrote relatively little organ music, but it's all of a wonderful quality. The famous Rhapsody, of course, is the E-flat major one, which is a wonderful little piece. The D-flat major one is a much more extended work, and there's much more to it, and it's very beautiful indeed. The main theme is heard quietly at the start on the flutes and on the strings and the oboes, and then it builds into a wonderful free fantasia, full organ in the middle, and then subsides with a little bit of humour towards the end. It gives a wonderful chance to show off some colours of the organ, no doubt inspired by the wonderful Cavaille Coll at La Madeleine. So here is the D-flat major fantasy by Saint-Saëns. And now, as they say, for something completely different. American organist Seth Bingham was organist of the Madison Avenue Presbyterian Church in New York City for nearly 40 years. He studied in the USA, but he also had lessons with Guillemont and with Vidor in his day. And he wrote an enormous amount of music for the church, but he also wrote a little bit of organ music, and that's what he's really known for. This little roulade is really a bit of cartoon music in some ways. It's got a swirling, twinkling little theme, trumpet fanfares, and a reflective middle section using the vox urbana, which is supposed to imitate a human voice. It's rather bleating away, a little bit like a sheep. But it's a little bit of fun, and it's quite hair-raising to play, so wish me luck. And finally tonight, this year, of course, we are paying homage to the great Marcel Dupré, because it's 50 years since his death, actually this month. So I've been trying to include in my recitals, as have many others, some of his music. Dupré was an extraordinary man, studied in Paris, of course, with Vidor and Vierne, but he was a complete organ virtuoso, and he played over 2,000 recitals all over the world and played the complete works of Bach from memory. He was an extraordinary character indeed, wrote an enormous amount of organ music, all of it quite hard, because he thought that since he had an amazing technique, everybody else ought to as well. So it's wonderful stuff. He was, of course, organist of Saint-Sulpice, succeeding Vidor in 1934. He taught at the American Conservatory in Paris, and then at the Paris Conservatoire itself. And many of the famous 20th century organists and organ composers were his pupils. So he was a towering figure in the last century. The Cortège and Litany actually started as a piece for a small orchestra, but he was encouraged while he was on a tour to arrange it for the organ, and it works beautifully as the organ. It has two themes. The first one that you hear is rather hymn-like, and the second one is the Litany theme. It's quite a Russian flavor to it, with repeated notes, and they combine beautifully. And although it is in some ways a sad opening and a sad piece, it builds to a wonderful, joyful conclusion at the end. So finally, Cortège and Litany by Dupré. Thank you very much for listening, and I do hope I'll see you at some point in Guildford in the future. Many thanks.